House Transportation Subcommittee Number Three. I am essentially taking over as temporary chairman as our esteemed colleague is recovering from surgery. It's probably maybe for some people a sign of the apocalypse that the chairman would be associated with my name in any capacity, but hopefully I'll be able to run this in my meeting. I'm also on Courts of Justice, which anybody who's ever had to go to courts knows that that could be quite a painful committee at times, at the length of time. So times when I am stuck in courts, my esteemed colleague, also Professor Beach, Delta Davis, will be sitting in my absence.
I just want you to know that I volunteered to do that for you, just in case.
We do have some housekeeping matters, just so for the members of the audience. I know we do have electronic sign up. My general attitude is we have a paper sign up, and if you're trying to touch the committee clerk, there's some people that have asked to move off on the docket. If you're a situation where you're a member of this committee and you have to be in another committee to present a bill, if you want me to pass me a note or a committee clerk no, and then let me know. We will try to obviously accommodate everybody's schedule. I know that we all have to be in a lot of places at the same time. My understanding first up is HB 1077, a procedural matter that is not going to be heard today, and the request of the patron to strike from the docket. Is there a motion to do so?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So moved. All right. Please, let's say before you vote. You use your flag. Yes. The subcommittee votes are now
Chairman of John McGuire, District 56, and lastly, 50 years ago, we probably had hundreds of drive-in theaters. The Commonwealth of Virginia is now down to five of them, so they're kind of rare, they're historic, they're nostalgic. In Goosen County, part of our district, we have an outdoor theater that's become popular, and people drive 2 hours away to go to it. For 8 years, they've been trying everything they could to get signs, those new signs on Interstate 64. And I learned that if you put a bill in, you attract a lot of attention. I think everybody in this room would agree with that. And then, third week in the legislature, I've heard sometimes the best bill is no bill at all. Well, all of a sudden, yesterday, we got a lot of objections on this bill that you were going to see today. So we called together everyone with all the objections, including VDOT, LIS, and some other folks. And together as a team, we solved the problem. The gentleman who's been trying for 8 years had tears in his eyes, and we got the signs. We'll have them up in 45 days or so. So I asked Mr. Chairman, you strike the bill. We solved the problem. That's what we were looking for. Thank you.
Outstanding. Delegate Wire, I commend you for being proactive and working the partners in the state government to get this done. So at request of the patron, is there the chair will entertain a motion to strike the HB 1048?
Strike. Yes.
Second.
Second. Please have it reflect your vote.
Thank you for coming back.
Thank you. Thank you, Doug.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Next up, I know that Eric, I think you're on a tight schedule, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Which bill are we hearing?
This is 1068.
Okay. And please state for the bill what the does and what action would like to see the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members, House Bill 1068 seeks to amend a provision of the Virginia Code which currently provides for the issuance of license plates commemorating current service in the Air Force Reserve, Army Reserve, Navy Reserve, etc. At the request of the constituent who was here, who was extremely proud of her former service in the Navy Reserve, she is requesting, and I'm asking on her behalf, that the bill, that the current legislation be amended to provide for the issuance of license plates for veterans of the Reserve Forces of the United States. Mary Wither Ball, who is a veteran of the Navy Reserve, is here in support of this bill.
Okay, is there any questions for the patron? Is there anybody here to speak? Anybody here to speak for the bill? And when you do, please make sure you say your name for the audience.
My name is Mary Wither Ball, and I'm from Portsmouth.
Okay.
And surprisingly nervous.
They don't bite, this is the courts.
That's what she said.
Jason has that fact.
Yeah.
Please, proceed, ma'am.
I asked Senator, Delegate Harris's staff to help me with this last summer when I realized that for once I wanted to have a Band-Aid day in Virginia, and I thought I would get one for the Navy Reserve, but I learned that because I did not retire from the Navy Reserve, I didn't qualify to have one. But I'm not in anymore, it's just a few years back. But I feel strongly that Virginia has many, many people who serve in the reserves, but for a shorter period than their career, because life events happen, like happened with me, that forced me to make a decision and just stay in for 2 years. This was a different kind of military history when you could get in for a senior. But my Navy Reserve time as a journalist, J-O-3, thank you very much, influenced me. And when I got out, I launched my own publication supporting Navy Corpsmen and United States Marines. That is live to this day, almost 20 years, nonprofit publication. But I would say that that time in the Navy Reserve inspired my life's work. And so it matters very much to me to be able to share that with the world. But more importantly, there's so many veterans in Virginia who I think the world should know, or these people in the world should know. We have so many people who volunteer to serve and would be very proud to have the place if they had access to them. And as we all know, the Reserve has did a lot of work in this war to back up.
Absolutely.
So that is my petition. Thank you so much.
Do any members of the committee have a question for the witness?
Yeah.
Go on.
I do have a question.
Yes.
Like you anyway.
I mean, it's probably not for our guests here, but what is the normal number of years you have to serve to be eligible for a license plate? If she's only had two, what's
is
the
there anybody who can beat up that can answer that question?
Rick Holcomb, DMV Commissioner, I don't believe there's any requirement. I served 8 years in the reserves, but I'm like you, I couldn't get one now because I'm not currently in the reserves.
Well, it's in or retired from, but the reserves are different than the regular military, so you know, that you have to be a certain age to retire. You can't be 20 years, it has to be 50, 64 years old. And even though I'm not that age yet, let's make that real clear.
All right.
That's the matter.
The clerk has the answer.
Mr. Chairman, currently the code of does not say how long you need to be a member. It just says you need to be a member. So in response to your question, it's not a threshold membership length you would need to meet.
Sure. So I like the idea, but what are we fixing if there's no threshold now?
So right now you, Mr. Chairman, right now you need to be a current member to get the license plate. This is changing it so that if you are a veteran,
is there anybody? I'm sorry. Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
What exactly will that plate look like? Maybe DMV can answer that as it relates to. There has to be some difference. Some difference.
It has the emblem of the particular branch on it.
Again, Rick Holcomb, DMV Commissioner. At this point, the plate doesn't say anything about active reservists. It just says reservists. And I don't think we need, I'm sorry.
It does say, it says Navy Reserve. It's Navy Reserve and has a different icon than the Navy itself.
Yeah, but I don't think we'd have to come up with a separate plate that says former Navy Reservist. I don't think that's the intent.
Yeah, it's for us to get what's currently issued.
Second. same court. It's a bad rap.
Could you be here for another hour?
I know.
You got a comment on the place, right?
Yeah, right.
Thank you all.
I out of respect for our intelligence, I'll take it from our bill back to the delegate. Do you have a speed limit?
Yes.
HB, if you please. You're carrying this.
You can't just go downstairs to do it.
Just for the audience, please say the name of the bill that you were addressing today.
Delegate Ransom, and I have House Bill 684.
Okay, and what is your bill due?
Okay, we're trying to go a little bit faster, 4 miles on our country roads. So we've got House Bill 684, Richmond County Board of Supervisors requested a VDOT to conduct a speed study along Route 3, to have the town of Warsaw, and that's a four-lane highway, and then we'll go to a two-lane, single-lane highway for about 30 miles. But in between there, you'll have about four-mile stretch, and what they're trying to do is go 60 miles. So they conducted the speed study, VDOT completed that in 2017, and said absolutely, there's 60 miles for that four-mile period. And what happens, you get behind a lot of farm equipment, you'll get behind boats, you know, trucks that are carrying boats, so that little short period is a period where you can pass. So that's what we're requesting.
All right, is there anybody here to, any questions for the patron? Are there anybody here in the audience to speak on behalf of the bill? Anybody to speak in opposition to the bill?
Move to report.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion for us, please reflect your vote.
Best place to use these for our revenue raisers.
Reports 8-0. Since the delegate talks, do you have a place you need to be, or are you sorry? I think we have next Delegate Weber. And the chairman was remiss, anytime we have a bill that either has an amendment or a substitute, we can always act on that first, so we can get that out of the way. That was something I should have asked.
Delegate Mike Weber, I have House Bill 114, and we have an amendment.
Okay. Second. All in favor? Any opposed? Bill for us with the line item amendment. May the patron speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this bill is intended to create a safer environment for golf carts and utility vehicles to cross from one side of the road to another during F1 events that we hold in and around our district. There are a couple in particular. We have the Upperville Horse Show, which is the oldest horse show in the Commonwealth, and free and very well attended. It's 4 days, and we have Loudon, which is also 4 days, and of course we have Gold Cup and those types of things. And it has been customary to use golf carts to travel back and forth between stables and things, because the events. A lot of these events, depending where they are, actually straddle by two-lane road, which is the reason for the amendment, because we wanted VDOT came to we talked to VDOT and they said they wanted to clarify that it's needed to not I-66 in which we're stopping. And the reason the bill came about was our sheriff discovered that they weren't operating legally on the road, and he would like to. Make sure that golf carts are legal, and there's other areas, so for instance, golf courses, et cetera.
So this is a decriminalization bill.
Yeah, decriminalization. With VDOT's help, we again pointed to the two-lane road, et cetera. And it's also got a 35 mile an hour speed limit, so during that time, obviously, there's a lot of people in and around the road, so they slow everybody down.
Golf parks are quite popular with the oceanfront, and I have seen people suit them up, so I'm glad you have a 35-mile-per-hour. Are there any questions for the patron of this bill? Is there anybody in the audience to speak for the bill? Please state your name for the audience.
Mr. Chairman, Ellen James on behalf of Fauquier County Board of Supervisors and the Sheriff's Office, and we really would appreciate if you would move this decriminalization bill along to help protect our citizens. Thank you.
Okay. Is there anybody to speak in opposition to this bill?
Report
with the amendments.
Divorce?
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Please reflect your vote.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Seeing that we have no other delegates not on the committee, we will go ahead and I think Delegate Bloxham is handling some matters, and Delegate Thomas will handle your HB 73.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. HB 73 is very similar to HB 684, which we just discussed with Delegate Ranson. It actually would include, currently there's a carve out for a very specific portion of Route 17. It would include the entirety of Route 17. It would add State Route 301, Route 3, and 207. The main difference between this and the previous bill is the safety studies have not been accomplished yet, but the George Washington Regional Commission, which is the planning district organization, has asked for this because they know localities want to be able to do it in the future. So when we pass this, it doesn't instantly increase the speed limits. We still have to provide the safety studies, and most of these roads are very rural in nature. There's a couple areas where safety studies wouldn't make sense, closer to the populated areas.
All right. Any questions for the patron? Anybody in the audience speak for the measure?
Mr. Chairman, Elton James on behalf of the region that was just identified. Would really help with traffic flow. And if you any of you have been up Route 301 through 48 E Hill, that's one of the biggest segments we're talking about. There's nobody. There's hardly even two or three intersections for about 10 miles. So it just seems it's really tempting to go faster than 55. And so this is a protection bill for
another decriminalization bill.
Exactly, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Anybody speak in opposition to that? Is there any motions? Is there a second? Could you come to vote on the truck 740? Congratulations.
Says that that an abided highway that has a maximum speed limit of 55 miles per hour or greater, the minimum speed limit shall be 45 miles per hour. So that's what the bill does.
Okay. This is not a decriminalization. Any questions for the Yes,
So I assume the next sentence after that is we'll say for the safe operation.
that allows for weather changes on that someone feels necessary, so that still covers that piece of the equation, correct?
Yes, but I'll ask my legal, I'll phone a firm.
Mr. Chairman and Delegate Davis, this is the same language that we use in 46.2-877 that relates to minimum speed.
I did read that last night.
Question for the patron, is there a physical impact statement, since they'll have to post minimum speed limit signs along this way on these highways, or maybe that's a question for Clark, how does this generally work?
Mr. Chairman, unlike Delegate Peters' favorite code section that he reads regularly, this section does not have a provision that would require VDOT to post signage, so as written, this would be kind of a rules of the road. Like reckless is 15 over, but we don't put signs to say that. So that's how it's written currently.
Question. Yeah, I guess my question is, this police would just be able to issue a ticket based on that?
I guess that's the way it works.
Yes.
I'm trying to figure out what is a limited access highway with the divided roadway, since I'm new to the committee. I want to make sure I'm sure where I am letting people go fast or not go slow.
Is that a question for the clerk, or that's a question for
the clerk? Let's get the correct answer, so we'll...
Actually, I believe that VDOT gave us the
okay. If someone from VDOT is here to testify, is that correct?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chair. I just off the top of my head.
Now, can you just please say your name?
I'm sorry, I'm Joanne Maxwell from VDOT.
Okay.
Off the top of my head, I think an example would be certain portions, maybe Route 460. It's limited access in certain areas and it's divided. So that would give you an example.
Okay, limited access, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Limited access, is that done by how many entrances or a mile? I mean, how do you measure that? Is that something where, like the roads on the Eastern Shore is dual lane, but yet we have a lot of slow moving traffic anyway. That would not be in this because we have too many inlets and access on it.
Mr. Chair, limited access is actually a designation that's made by the Commonwealth Transportation Board. So a particular road, it has to be declared a limited access highway in order for it to, but you are correct. Basically what then happens is the principle is, or the philosophy that's applied to those roads, is they do try to limit the entrances and exits onto that particular roadway. The idea being it's intended to be more of a throughput thoroughfare.
Can I ask you a question?
I fully confess that I take it he's allowed. Is he allowed to do that? This is my first time chairing a committee, so this is sunny apocalypse.
Well, I'm trying to get you in trouble.
I don't want there to be a trap door there.
So Joanne, then limited access also, it depends on how many driveway entrances go into a limited access, depends on the speed limit that is posted on that road. VDOT has told me that before in the past. Did they tell me?
Mr. Chair, I mean, that's accurate. Generally, a limited access road tends to have higher speed limits. I mean, it's more conducive to higher speed limits. A roadway that has many more entrances, et cetera, tends to maybe have lower speed limits because of the cars going in and out.
Sure, that's good.
I have a question. So when I think of limited access, it's always the interstates or limited access, like I said. Do we have regular 460s? Are they designated limited access? Because if you have a light on, I mean, if you have a light, that's not really limited access, or just portions of it.
Mr. Chair, sometimes it is indeed portions. Yeah. Again, for instance, I think Route 460 is an example of portions.
But that's in the code. Or do you guys have it stated somewhere?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, it's basically a matter of record because the CTB has declared it to be limited access, and you are correct. He's correct. The interstates are one form of limited access highways. They are all limited access.
But I would imagine, since this utilizes roads that are only a maximum speed limit of 55 miles an hour, there would be no limited access. There's never a limited access road that's 65 miles an hour because you can't slow down for a stoplight from 55. Since we're high. Yeah, we're high, but not lower. So there. I guess the question is is there such thing as a limited, a non-limited access road that's 55?
Yes.
Is there a stoplight on a 55 mile an hour road?
Yes, Mr.
Really?
Mr. Chair, there could very well be. Mr. Chair, I can give you an example. Yeah, I think perhaps about 54 might be an example.
55-0.
Is there not, most of them have a flashing light before the 55, before on the 55 or 60, that that you recognize that that light up there is turned yellow, turned red? Well, they do in my area.
Chair, I will have to confess ignorance on that one.
Yes, is there a representative from VDOT? Either to speak for or against the bill? Or
Mr. Chair, I am from VDOT.
What's your opinion of this legislation?
Mr. Chair, we had significant concerns with the original bill, and that was partially because of the fact that there are roads where we do, for instance, one example of a road, we have certain roads where we have variable speed limits, and we can reduce the speed limits based on conditions, etc. Another situation that may have been addressed by this is pursuant to section 46.2877, the commissioner has authority to lower speed limits in certain portions of the road, such as the road, etc. And this, we had concerns with that because that seemed to totally negate discount that, the existence of that authority. Now that this is in there, I'm just not sure exactly what our assessment would be. So the earlier version of the bill was certainly trouble with, I had concerns with. This one, I'm just not sure. I'd have to take it back and let folks.
So is it safe to say right now you're neutral, but you could come back in full committee and oppose it? Would that be an accurate statement?
You could come back and endorse it.
Or endorse it.
I think that's a fair, Mr. Chair, or we could come back and have no position.
Okay. The question that I would have, does this in any way affect, and I'm thinking maybe for approximately sure, this is any vehicle, and maybe Madam Clerk can answer this, does this in any way apply to tractors or things of that nature?
That's a whole other section.
Is that a different section of the code?
Chairman, there would be there's a whole another section that governs how fast mopeds, tractors, I believe mopeds can't go over 35 miles an hour, or something like that. So there are more specific sections that would govern those vehicles. And I do believe that because we have the catch-all of, except when there's, if you can't do it, it's going to save operation of the vehicle. I don't think that those vehicles would be affected negatively.
Farm equipment has to have the signage on the back of it to the triangle.
Oh, yeah.
So it can be about, I think it's an hour after sundown, an hour before sundown.
I would just, before we get to full, I would just like, for my own personal identification, I'd like to be curious about that. I just want to make sure. Maybe it's a lawyer, maybe get in that little section of the code that are contradictories. I would just like to know exactly where it is, because what I don't want is somebody's operating farm equipment, suddenly get ticketed for not going faster than 45 miles an hour. And maybe it's a moronic question, I don't know, but I would personally.
Yeah, with that device comply, I look into report. So.
Okay, it's a simple. All right. I'm sorry, I don't think there, I very much apologize before we do the vote. I think there's some additional gentlemen here to speak.
Mr. Chairman, Bud Black from Richmond Area Bicycling Association. We've got 1,100 members here in this area, and we get a little bit nervous when somebody starts talking about minimum speeds. Generally speaking, the Commonwealth Transportation Board, on what they consider limited access highways, eliminates us and says bicycles and some other types of vehicles are not supposed to be on that road. And that, they have that jurisdiction, and they do that fairly regularly. I can cite you some examples here. I don't have a copy of the bill today that you're talking about, and I didn't see anything about limited access in there. What I saw in there was primary highway. And that made me very nervous, because we've got some, what I believe are primary highways here in the city of Richmond and Henrico County and the Environs, which would be Broad Street, which would be, I'm not sure Staples Mill Road, but there are several. Patterson Avenue, I believe, is in that category. And to put a minimum limit on there would be a problem, because people are going to work on that road. There are no bike lanes. There are no other alternative access routes for those people who are going to work on a bicycle or recreationally on a bicycle. And that would prohibit them from being on there, a minimum speed limit of 35 or whatever, because we don't go that fast.
Mr. Chairman, I mean, to hear the gentleman's point that you said on primary, I think the substitute switch to the limited access.
Limited access, I would not have a problem with that, because it's my understanding most of the limited access, all the ones I know of, the Commonwealth Transportation Board has ruled that they, that bicycles and certain other slower moving vehicles not be on them.
Yes, I think
and they have that authority, and they do it routinely.
Okay. Well, anybody else in the audience here to speak for or against the bill? Okay, there was a motion on the floor, move to report, and I think there was a second, correct? With the substitute? Motion on the floor is to report HB 428 and substitute. All right. 7-1.
So do I need to come to the floor?
I think unfortunately, I assume the chairman, yeah, we may want to check the chairman.
Thank y'all. Have a good day.
All right, my understanding is that Delegate Blocks and Booth has
Delegate Edmonds and
would you like to take your bill first? You would like to take your bill.
We can go with HB 55, Delegate Edmonds first.
Okay.
Similar to the other bills that passed. He is asking that on Highway 501, which is a divided dual lane highway from South Boston to North Carolina Line, speed limit be raised to 60 miles an hour. The Halifax County Board of Supervisors have requested this. VDOT is fine with the bill as written. Virginia State Police are fine with it as it is written. But the engineering speed study to determine which sections is yet to be done yet.
Okay.
Will be done if this passes.
All right. Any questions for location. Or the gentleman
doesn't need to
the Sherpa. The Sherpa.
For clarity, Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
Does move from 55 to 60.
Yes, sir. On certain sections, whatever the engineering study allows.
So just clarifying a question from the chairman. So you're saying that the speed limit can be increased that there's an engineering study?
Yes, when VDOT will conduct a full engineering study to determine which sections will remain at 55 and which will be increased to 60. But the Board of Supervisors has asked them to do it, but they can't do it without it.
Okay. This is standard. Correct. Okay. Is there a motion to advance AP 55 before we make?
Second. Second bill, I will take whichever one comes first and go on, sir.
Well, why don't we save Delegate Ferris's for last?
Okay. All right. My bill is a bill that actually DMV helped me craft. Wallops Island wanted a license plate. Langley has one. The only thing they really want to change on the license plate is the wording. But DMV could not do that without this authorization. So that's what I'm asking to do, is just allow DMV to change the verbiage in the code so they can, instead of having Langley, NASA Langley, it'll say NASA
NASA walks off.
Move to report, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Is there a second? All right.
Do you have to have the 450, or these are plates that are already done?
No, so they're already, that's just verbiage changes, Bob.
I need to move to report in a second. Yes, the last one is dumping animal carcasses. Why am I not surprised? Dumping animal carcasses on public property. But I guess he has roped you in.
Roped me into this one, yes, sir.
So please.
House Bill 1458. Actually, I think this was given to Delegate Ferris from DGIF. And basically, what they want to do is to prevent dumping of animal carcasses on public property and put a fine to it if they're caught. $250 and not more than $2,500. That's also private property.
Is this a problem?
Yes, during deer season it is a problem, yes.
They feel dressed?
Yeah, they feel dressed.
Lovely.
Right.
Okay. Is there any questions for the Sherpa as delegate? Yes.
Just because I'm looking at this, not only the equipment and money, but I guess it's also potential jail time. I understand maybe the deer piece, but when you start talking about, you know, your daughter full of fish, or something else, I'm just wondering, is it for deer and we're encompassing other animals, or is there a problem with all these carcasses? Because I could imagine something happens and you throw, you kind of rash out the window. Yeah. Is there an overall problem with all this stuff, or just as a little?
Deer is the main problem that we have in our area. Fish carcasses usually get left at the dock and float away. Crabs eat them, so that's not as big of a problem. But deer is the main problem with this that I have in my area.
Okay.
But I cannot answer the rest of the question.
It seems a little extreme that for maybe a fish or a bird, face the $2,500.
Well, and punishable in jail for not more than 12 months. Is there a tax statement associated with this legislation?
Not that I know of.
So I just so I'm clear, if I throw in my daughter's goldfish, we don't have goldfish. But I do know there is a delegate in our caucus that daughter did have a pet rat. So hypothetical serious scenario, if that delegate's daughter threw a pet rat out the window, or he did it on behalf of his daughter, he could be punishable in jail for 2 months.
Mr. Chairman, I'd also say if you were caught littering, there's some heavy fines on that, but I don't know if
it's
anyone here actually done
the same error.
It says impairment.
I would consider that trash.
Delegate Davis.
Mr. Chairman, would it be appropriate and reasonable to amend this by putting a weight scenario on there? So, in excess of, let's say, 25 pounds, 50 pounds, something that exempts someone who inch dies and they're just trying to get rid of it before the cake is home?
So your potential amendment is carcass is not more than 25 pounds.
No, in excess of.
In excess of. Okay. Yes.
I was carrying this game. You know what? I think a lot of people are going to have concerns about this. I think if we're going to vote on this, it may go south. Do we want to let the
Patron here, and we can hear his entertaining.
And no offense, he'll probably be a little funnier.
I look forward to that. Let's pass five for the day. Is there a motion?
Second.
My understanding is that's not a report. That's a voice vote. All in favor? Opposed? Seeing that we do not have anything else on the docket, is there a motion to adjourn? Second.